Okay, thank you for this opportunity to talk here. I am Leo Granberg, I am from Helsinki, University of Helsinki. We are a research group from different sciences and an artist, Anu Osva. The photos here are taken and prepared by Anu Osva. I'm also happy to be here because this is the first time some results from our research project is presented in Russia, in the Russian Federation. Okay, the relationship between human being and cattle is a very basic relationship in human communities and societies. In history, cattle were migrating with people from one region to another and adapting themselves to new environments and climatic conditions. Cattle became part of life and identity of these people. During the last century, the connection between humans and cattle has been broken, however. In Saha, Yakutia, there is still living a small population of local cattle breed, Saha Unaga, or Yakutsky Scott, or Yakutian cattle. It has many features of an ancient cattle breed, which has been verified in genetic analysis of our researchers in our group. Juha Kantanen, to mention, especially one person. The topic of the research project was to study this cattle and social change in the villages where it is living. The second outcome was an art project. Saha is a land of diamonds, mammoths, shamanism, and permafrost. We took a flight from Yakutsk to Sakurir, the village of Sakurir in northern Yakutia. Yakutian cattle exist in three remote villages in Evenobutantai district, and some words about what kind of region this is. It is located behind Verhoyansk Mountains. It is the coldest populated area in the world. It's a very remote area, but it is not totally isolated. They have flight connections, and you can take a car in winter time and drive 4 days and nights, and you are there. But not in the summertime, there are no roads. Earlier it was a region of Tungus people, as they are called. Now, today they are Evens and Evenks. So it is a region to which Yakuts migrated centuries ago for reasons we don't know. Even a Butantai, it is a common region for reindeer herders, the Eveni, and cattle and horse keepers, the Yakuts. We are arriving to the village Sakurir soon. Sakurir is the main village. The other two villages are smaller. They are Kustur and Zargala. In the village, we can find very modern features. This is the village. So it's something like 1,000 600 inhabitants. So there is modern and traditional things. They have internet connection, not so well functioning anyway. They have TV, cars in the village because there are roads inside the village. And winter time there is winter road between three villages. And there are a lot of educated professional persons, veterinaries, teachers, public officers. And there are old traditions, they still have quite strong animist belief system. They are hunting and fishing, not like a hobby, but for food. They have small cowsheds covered with manure. Yakutian cattle is living in these villages. They are moving freely in the village in the daytime. The number, and they are just enjoying their life. This is April time, and it's already not much frost. And of course there is permafrost, which is something like maybe 200 meters deep. So the number of this cattle, it is totally like 1,200 animals. In these villages there are 900 animals, cows 500, and so it has been very threatened animal. This is cowshed. They are cheap, they are easy to build, and every Yakut can build a cowshed. Every Yakut man can build a cowshed, it was told. Cows go every day to drink water from the river or the lake, and they return home by themselves, they know the way. There they are going. And here you see the big earlier cowshed, which is still in the use. Because of permafrost, hay is not cultivated at all. It is collected from the natural meadows, some of them very far from the village. Hay making is hard work, it is difficult. And it is a common effort for the village. Cows are born in springtime, most milk is produced in summer, and it stops, milk production stops when the cold winter times start. This is a video film from haymaking. So this cattle is the last Siberian Turano-Mongolian cattle breed. Turano-Mongolian breeds exist only in Asia, and they are not many. Genetical analysis of its mitochondrial DNA tells that it has both European and Asian origin. There is a genetic contribution of female East Asian aurochs, that is wild ox, which doesn't exist anymore. It disappeared like 400 years ago. This is known because mitochondrial DNA is inherited from cow to cow, that is from mother to child, mother line. Amazing is the diversity of these cows. They are all separate looking. They are individuals. One question in our research Ixkas was whether people are moving out from the villages and there is nobody taking care of these cattle. But this was not the case. In fact, the number of population is quite stable. Of course, young people are moving out to study or to find work from the central Yakutia, but very much they are moving back later on. And they seem to have strong identity to the region in large. Yakutian cattle has met two dramatic transitions in the last century. The first transition took place in the 30s and onwards when the Soviet system was brought to Yakutia. The second transition followed 20 years ago when the socialist system collapsed. This is from our research group. We are interviewing people, Yakuts and Eveni, poor people and leaders of the communities. The population, as mentioned, no dramatic changes. And there are a lot of young people, there are boys and girls. So this is from the time before these two transitions. In this time, Yakuts were living in the same building with cows. You see a cow on the right side. A head of cow is there. The first transition moved people from small settlements along the riversides to few permanent villages. Cows were collected to production cooperatives, kolkhozes. Yakuts and reindeer herding even families were ordered to move into these villages. In the Soviet model of modernization, all Yakutian cattle were slaughtered or mixed with better European cattle breeds. Also, in the studied village, crossbreeding was experimented. How was it possible that Yakutian cattle survived this period? The decisive reason was the local activity, acts of local people and some academic researchers. Local people knew the high value of this cattle in practical sense, but so did also people in other villages where it disappeared. And furthermore, some animal breeding specialists studied in St. Petersburg. They paid attention to the value of Yakutian cattle and they acted against the mainstream policy. There was public debate on this matter in Soviet Union. But in these villages, after gross breeding took place, in the end, local actors made the decision to slaughter crossbred cattle. They decided to eat this crossbred cattle, and they did it. So Yakutian cattle was saved, and Butantai River Valley became the ecological niche for the survival of Yakutian cattle. Second transition came with privatization of the Soviet system, and this was the reason we started our research. The economic system collapsed and difficult times started. State farms were partly privatized, partly closed, partly continued activity. Most animals were distributed to private families. After that, there was hunger times, poverty. Horses and reindeers were slaughtered in mass scale. About half of them were eaten up. But Yakutian cattle was again saved. Why? In this picture you see the yellow line is the Yakutian cattle, so it went down, but it was much more stable again. But reindeer's horses is red and reindeer's is blue one. So there are many reasons why Yakutian cattle was saved. But I think the main reason was diversity in cattle breeding. There were many different ways to organize cattle breeding. To keep it just in families, or to keep it established registered enterprises, fermery families, farmers families, or to keep it in state research farm, which was in the end established. Now 1/5 of cattle is on this farm. But also reindeer herders keep this cattle, so it is everyone's cattle in these villages. Here, this old lady has established quite large cattle herd, like 10, over 10. And this young family is working outside home. Father is entrepreneur, mother is working for the municipality, but they want to keep cattle because she's learned to do it at home in her youth, and they get additional food and perhaps some money of it. And this is a young farmer. And now there are different interests to keep Yakutian cattle. The situation looks better. There are global, local, and national interests. Is this enough to save it? We don't know. And then some words about the artist project, which was a project by Anu Osva. In this project, the artistic part could benefit from cooperation with the researchers. On the other hand, it was quite difficult for the researchers to recognize the benefit from the artistic project for research. I would like to underline just one basic aspect here. In scientific work, each scientist is more or less a prisoner of his or her own theoretical context. The scientific discipline and its concepts and theories. And it is difficult for scientists to work together in deep sense. But this is not the case with an artist. Artist can move freely on the whole surface of the research object and move across the scientific boundaries. This makes it possible for an artist to act as a promoter of multidisciplinary cooperation in a combined research and art project. Okay, Anu Osva worked with the cattle for 1 week in the village Sakkurer. She was doing this in order to learn to know cows and to learn colors in this place. One outcome of the outcome of this work was artworks called Yakutian Cattle Exploring Expedition to Siberia in the 2000s. These portraits of cows, They are needed because almost nobody has seen these cows. What is special here is to present cows in portraits not as production animals, but as individuals, as the tradition goes with human beings. They are hanged in gallery on the level of viewers' eyes. In this space, they are equals to human viewers. And this work is called Mother's Pears. It's hanging on the wall, it is made of plaster. This is describing a piece of mitochondrial DNA of Yakutian cattle. Three pieces are different. They have red back, and maybe you can up there see one of these different pieces. So this is scientifically based artwork. And it is, in fact, here, this is the code from which it is made. And this is, in fact, the first time it was published ever, this new code. Researchers' works were just going around journals to get the permission to be published. Okay, this work is Siberian Sky. An important starting point in these works is that cattle are outcomes of two basic factors, of genetic code and of environment where they live. So therefore Siberian Sky reflecting the environment, but in this work you also see in some parts DNA code. And this work is nine paths, I take it like nine evolutionary roads of this cattle. And these are co-travelers, it is near the natural sites of cows. The concept co-travelers was developed during the art project by artist Anu Osva. It refers to the long companionship between humans and cattle. In the paintings you can see how cattle are growing from their environment, from snow and ice, from Siberian winter, from the harsh climate and the barren soil. Cattle is made of genes and of environment. In this last photo, you see our Yakutian colleagues with co-travelers. They were visiting the artist's studio in Helsinki, and this is how they themselves wanted to stay there in the photo. These cattle are co-travelers for the Yakuts, for Innocenti and Ruslan here. They are part of their identity. Thank you.